friendships tonight. I want you to think about how important it is to have a Christian friend. We're going to see a lot of this within the lesson and the encouragement that Paul the Apostle received. A lot of times we just talk about Paul. He writes 3/4 of the New Testament, awesome, Damascus Road, all these things he's gone through, but friends were with him. Actually, the book of Acts, if you remember, we introduced it. Dr. Luke wrote this, and he was alongside Paul in these places that he went to. So we want to think about those friends because we're going to be able to see some of those friends as Paul goes through tonight. As we jump back into Acts 19, remember last time we had entered into the riot at Ephesus. Paul the Apostle is shaking up the Ephesus, the Ephesian area. He's coming against false gods, and that's what we're going to deal with tonight. Going back to just a little history, someone read 21 through 22 as we jump into this section with Paul. Which is going to come up a lot in the scriptures, being Paul the Apostle oftentimes his right-hand man. Look as we go into this 23rd verse. Even when you got friends, the gospel is going well for you, we see this cycle with Paul the Apostle. And the only way to understand this cycle is God told him, Christ told him on the Damascus Road, he was going to have to suffer many things for the gospel's sake. I'm telling you, this is a tough one. If God called us, and at the get-go, he said, Johnny Kelly, you're going to suffer a whole bunch for this sake. A lot of us be like, Lord, not me. Get somebody else. I cannot handle it. But suffering can be a part of the call, and we see that because in verse 23, where we stopped on last time, the devil never leaves Paul alone. Any amen to that? He never leaves him alone. Someone read that next verse, please. Love that. Commotion, what does it mean? Yeah, disturbance, confusion about the, what do they call it? The way. The way. Not ways. The way. All right? What is the way?
One way.
One way. What is the gospel? The good news of Jesus Christ. If I'm going to tell somebody the gospel, what do I tell them? What do I make sure I get to them? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. That's the crux. Paul the Apostle said it over and over. When you hear his sermons preached, he always focused on Christ's death, his burial, and his resurrection. No matter where he started, that was always a part of the gospel, and that was the one way. That is the way. A lot of people coming up with a lot of small W's of ways, plurality, but I'm telling you, there is one way. And as the time gets darker, it's going to become tough. We talked about this over and over again. People in this day don't mind you worshiping God. They don't mind you worshiping Muhammad or Buddha or some other false god. But there's something about Jesus, and I've experienced this firsthand. I used to pray for a lot of big places, and it was okay at first to pray in Jesus' name. And then I found out they started kind of saying things like, we want you to pray, but could you just not use Jesus' name? And they would be very nice, and they would say, you know, it offends people. But I saw them allowing other people get up there, and they would use Muhammad and stuff, and everybody clap and everything. But they would tell those not to use Jesus because it was offensive. I'm like, why is that? And so I had to make some decisions some years ago that I can't be a part of that because I'm not going to play the game, and I don't want to get up there. And if they don't want Jesus, they don't have to have me. Now, some people feel like that, you know, they should just go and just yell out Jesus in there. That's just not my personality. There are preachers that say, okay, I'll do it. But they agree not to say Jesus, but when they get up there, they say Jesus. I think that's deceptive, and that's lying, and that's hypocritical. So this whole process, because of Christ, this great commotion occurs. Someone read that commentary, please. Go ahead, Eugene. People are being converted. They're becoming aware that their idols have no power. That's why they don't want us to lose the name Jesus, because when you start using that name Jesus and people start being converted, lives are changed. Now it's affecting, we talked about the pocketbook. And I really believe the enemy uses the pocketbook a lot, especially in the United States, for control. And there's the vibes of the idols, but it really comes down to money matters. I'm seeing this technology. I love technology, but it can become so distracting. Driving in our cars, we talk about this phones. Everybody has a phone. They're looking at their text and doing all these other things rather than looking at what's coming in front of them. All of these things are coming, and I'm wondering, could this be a ploy of the enemy just to keep us distracted, keep us focusing on other stuff and not on prayer? Somebody in this church, I'm not going to call their name because they're not here today, but we were talking in one of our couples' ministry, and we were just talking about intimacy. And this lady said, you know what, I wish my husband would hold me like he holds that phone. I said, ooh. Everybody got quiet. They're like, oh my goodness, because we started to realize, and she explained, she's like, he's always holding on the phone and looking at it and rubbing it, pushing buttons and all that. I'm like, okay, that's enough. But this whole process, what has the enemy... Gee, I see that here. What has the enemy done to distract us? So, commotion comes because now people are becoming focused and they don't need the props anymore. They don't need the idols, and now it's affecting what matters. Someone read that next verse, please. All right, what's going on in this world? All right, Demetrius has cornered the market on what? On the silver, because the silver makes who? The shrines of Diana, right? So people are worshiping idols. So he had decided, man, I can do silver, so I'm going to make these idols, and people will buy them from me. But what's going on? What's happening? Business is shrinking because people are getting converted to Jesus. They're loving Jesus now. They don't want any more idols of Diana. They're not buying it for their cousins no more. They ain't giving it for Mother's Day, Father's Day. And he's looking at his profits go down. And so now he's got all these extra idols that are sitting in the window, and people aren't buying them, all because of Christ. So instead of him, you know, getting on a bandwagon, he's thinking about, I got to feed my family. Mm-hmm. So how do we stop Jesus? And that's where our society is. How can we stop the advancement of Christ? And please, today, understand this. If they could have stopped it, they would already stop it. If they could have closed down all the churches, they would have closed them down. But you cannot stop the advancement of the gospel. Look at this. Diana is the Latin for the Greek Artemis, a many-breasted fertility goddess. Now, this is very important. I told you on last time that we'd be talking about this. Diana was hinged in sexuality. This is one of the big things that in America now, pornography, is not just the things that people are looking on their phones or their computers. It's a spirit. It is a spirit that's going across America. Pornography is a multi-billion-dollar industry, and it has advanced alcohol, drugs, all of those things, pornography. And coming into the virtuality, I actually went to a seminar dealing with pornography in the church. Not that we look at it, but how many men and women have become addicted to this spirit. Well, guess what? It's the same spirit that was in Ephesus. People were addicted. They had their idols. But what they would do, they would actually go to the temple. They would get their idols from the blacksmith, Demetrius, and they would take them to the temple. And there they would do sexual acts right there in the temple to worship their God. So they would have pleasure, all of these things, in the name of their God. And guess what? It was booming business. Right? It was booming business, even here. They say that prostitutes, the oldest industry, continues on. It's illegal, but it still happens in Greensboro, still happens in Charlotte, still happens in Raleigh. Why? Because it's bigger than just a person. It's a spirit. The enemy is trying to get in our mind. He's trying to take us off the true belief of Christ. So now the industry is attacked. When the church advances so powerfully and people start not partaking of those things that are in the world, issues come. They do. Because now money is being affected. Look at that next verse I'm going to read. So what does he do? We got to have a meeting. Yeah, we got to get a meeting. I got to get all the other my support, but also those who were in concert. What's the word I'm looking for? When you're doing the same thing with someone down the street. Yeah, your business. You got one business that's kind of going against another business. What's that called?
Competition.
Thank you. I just couldn't pull it up there. So now his competition that he had been against, he calls them over. We got the same issue. Your pocketbook's being affected. My pocketbook is being affected. What can we do to stop this? Look at that question. What happens when the gospel impacts your pocketbook? And then that's what we're dealing with. What habits change when we become more like Christ? And this is kind of open for now. I want you to think, when we become more like Christ, we start following the word of God. What habits change when concerning our pocketbook? Anybody? All right. We start not spending so much money on ourselves, but we start giving. We start reaching out to others. And this is one of the things, giving. I remember early in our marriage, Bianca and I told this story, and she's shaking her head. And we went to church, and we were somewhere, it was the preacher went all that or anything like that. And oftentimes came. And so, I was doing good, Lord was blessed, and I don't know where I got the money. I had given her a $20 bill. Well, a $20 bill was supposed to last her a whole month. Right? Don't look at me like that. It was supposed to last her a whole month. So she had this crisp $20 bill. We're in church. Offering plate comes. Instead of getting change, anybody from old school, Castle County, all that, you take change. $20, you come up there, you come up to the people who give it out the money, you say, I need 19 back. That's the way it was supposed to happen. But my wife, because it affects our pocketbook, she's a giver. She put the whole thing in. And I said, well, what changes? She said, I didn't have change. I just put the whole thing in. That affected my pocketbook. So this process, we do. Diane hit on that. When we love the Lord, we give more. Somebody else. Yes, ma'am.
Really learn to
pay out 10%. All right. Okay. We start to understand what giving is about. And so now, it's not just a 10% or whatever. We're giving as we teach, not just on Sunday, but all during the week. Because God has been good. Has God been good to you? When you start reading the word and understanding, you're like, oh my goodness. The Lord has just been so, so good, and you want to bless that whole cycle, that turnover. Yes, ma'am.
You also realize what you have in your life. And sometimes, some people just like to give. I just do. Well, you said one day, I guess before, when you get what the kids, because you always give me stuff. But like I said, I just wanted to give because so much of it was given to me. But, and then I had issues with receiving. I was like, you know, just like, I don't know, that was something else going on. I'm not receiving. But to give, you just, and I asked the Lord, I said, why am I always doing this? Am I doing it because I'm trying to get some breadcrumbs with you, God? I'm going to be real. I mean, I'm not doing this because I want something back, you know, and they tell you, you give, and you know, a lot of churches, it's like, you know, you sow a seed, you give, stuff come back. So I wondered if God was in my heart as to why I was giving. And I said, you know, I don't want to be like that. And then he just let me know, he said, well, that's me. I gave, that's a part of you, my spirit in you, to make sure you want to give. And so I had to get this in my head. And so, you know, then it was just freedom, and I didn't worry about, you know.
Good point. That whole process, it changes you. Now it's not some kind of formula. What other things besides giving? I know y'all love giving. Y'all great givers. What other things? Dick, you hit him. See, we give a lot. When you fall and you understand, he's our provider, Brother Rob.
I want to talk about when you put your little brother on, put up in his best friend, it makes you appreciate every good thing that he got done for me. You get up in the morning and you get up in the morning. 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 So I look at appreciation as something that is very important in the life that we believe in.
All right, so it affects our pocketbook in a sense. We don't take things for granted. A lot of people are buying things to try to get happiness. You know, if I could just have that, I'm not going to tell you what I want, but if I could just have that, whatever it is, then I would be really happy. And so we work to spend, and we get that, and we're happy for a bit until we have to pay for it. And so it affects our pocketbook. Now I'm just happy to be alive, and I don't have to buy things to have peace on the inside because of Jesus, that whole transform. Rick?
I like to turn around that there are negative impacts where especially now, because if you stand up for the gospel, you can get fired from your job.
Good, Rick. Good point. So when we get on fire for the Lord, sometimes we're not complacent anymore where we were. We can't stay at that point. And that's where the walk of faith, and we've got to find out where God really wants us so it can impact. We've got some high professionals that are part of Ebenezer, and they're realizing the higher up they get, the more money they get, but the more life is gone. And so they're having to make choices.
Right.
More money, stay away, or less money, and more Jesus. And that's what it's coming to.
Right.
And so, good point, Rick. Brother James.
But also, if you
learn
how to budget, you can also control
your budget. Amen. Getting close to the Lord, you learn where the thrift shops are. Salvation, you do, because you understand, hey, that could be a blessing, more money so I can give and reach out. Good point. Yes, sir.
That's what's strange, you're talking about giving. This couple might have been in their late 30s, early 40s. Lady went up to my car and she said, I don't want no money. All I want you to do is make sure that hand moves. I said, what hand? I see both of your hands moving from mine. So my thing is, you know, I saw it once again. And I said, Lord, forgive me. But I can't give these people nothing. Because they're here at this gas pump trying to get over on people. One lady gave her $10, told her, put it all in there. I'm not moving to put it in there. She went in the store. She come back out. That guy, a friend, he ran to the store. He told her to put $5 in. Then when I got ready to pull off, they pulled around to the other side of the pump, waiting on somebody else to pull in the kick game. So I'm saying that affects you with your giving. You know, you get a trip to give. But you can't not just take, I mean, people take you for granted. I say, Lord, search my heart. If I'm wrong, God, forgive me.
So that discernment, look at this next verse, because I think that's Brown points out a point when it affects the pocketbook of the other side. So let's look at, we're looking at the silversmiths, the ones that are making the idols, just as the ones who are running gimmicks. All right, what happens when the gospel changes people, takes them off the street? Look at this next part, verse 26, and I think there are a few more hands. Someone read that and come back over.
Moreover, we see and hear that not only at Ephesus, but throughout almost all ages, this Paul has persuaded and turned away many people, saying that they are not gods which are made with hands.
This is key as we're thinking about it, impacting pocketbooks. What is their accusation against Paul? What has he done? Andrew? Brown, what if we walk in enough anointing in those situations, not just to discern whether people are running scams, but God gives us so much wisdom that you start talking to that lady and calls her not to do that anymore. She goes back to her guy and says, I can't do this. I was talking to this big dude, bald head, and he started giving some wisdom. This is wrong.
Pastor Bush, that guy was bigger than me.
Y'all pray for Brown. Y'all pray for Brown, huh? We can pray for Brown. So this whole process here, this is Paul the Apostle. He's making so much impact that people are literally, their mindsets are being changed. They don't want the idols anymore because they're loving Jesus. And that's where I want us to come to the point. We have discernment. We can see people are doing wrong. But can we walk in the wisdom of God that literally they understand their wrong ways and go to Jesus? That's when you're changing stuff.
Yeah.
One thing that I know, we don't worry about it. We do what we're supposed to do, and God has got the rest. That it all be here.
Send the agenda. There may be some here that, you know, wait for your ticket to come up, you know, that's logic. You know, you're justifying, but I'm warning you, the more you read the Word of God, the more you're going to be convicted, because the statistics say that you're not going to win, and you're kind of wasting. I know everybody wants to be like Beef Burgers, Biff Burgers, that guy that keeps winning. I'm still wondering how he keep winning, you know, but I know that. But we stay in church that God provides for our needs, so why do we? I know somebody's there. I heard it in my spirit. Lord, he can use the lottery, preacher. He can. Yeah, I guess he can. But wouldn't it be better if we could just trust him? Right? We could ask him for our provisions and we can give. Because he said it's more blessed to give than receive. That's not what we're really talking about at this point. But please understand, it's about changing our mindset and our thoughts. Very important. Yes, ma'am.
We have to also realize money is a commandment, which is a
a power in itself.
Spirit, you're right.
A spirit, yeah, and he said,
that's a great point. As we get closer to God and these people are experiencing this, their love for money changes. So we see it in Demetrius. He loves money. That's why he's trying to get everybody together. It's bigger than him that he doesn't even understand the spiritual implications. He's dealing with Diana, but that's just kind of a back set. He's like, my pocketbook is being affected. But these people are walking away, and now they realize Christ is their sufficiency. Is there another hand? Yes, sir.
Someone mentioned about the one person who didn't know, and that means so much. I thought I was going to say, you know, on the beach, we walk a while. So when we know something, why do we need to be
And what we see in the world is the world is screaming. I'm concerned about some things, and I don't really want to get into them tonight. This happened. There's been a few people. And I'm like, where's the church? Where are we when it comes to those things? And then it's entering into the church, and we have the book, but yet we don't want to speak out for what's in the book. And that question, I just want you to think about, how many people have we impacted? Not just say come to Ebenezer, but impacted, that lives have been changed because maybe they were looking at us or our friendship, our love for them, showing them that it's about Christ. And then the transformation part. That's what I want. I don't want people just to come to church. Thank you for being here tonight. But I want you to live Christ every day. Every day. I want you to be loving one another. I want you to be working through your issues with the power of the Lord. This is what Paul the Apostle is doing in this area. And it's causing all kinds of problems. It's commotion. Look at this next verse. Can we get on the hands? Someone read, please.
What happens when the gospel impacts the apostle?
Verse 27.
Yeah. So not only is Christian and how the danger of Paul is disrepute, but also the temple of the great goddess Diana may be the despise of her magnificent destroyed, whom all the angel and the world worship.
Good. So, he's talking about money, but what does he add on to it? Alright, it's affecting our pocketbook, and we love Diana. Pocketbook first, and the idol. Pocketbook first, and the idol. And you gotta realize, sin is run by pocketbook first, in the idol. It's about, it can be from alcohol, it can be from cocaine, whatever. Pocketbook first, then the idol. Money. Those who have the money, they're running. A lot of people are doing, pushing forth the drug. They don't even take a drug. It's about money, and then they're getting the people caught on it, and that spirit is taking over, that whole process. So again, this trade of ours is in danger of falling. Alright, it's gonna fall simply because that disrepute is talking about that people are going away from it. And if they don't believe in it, they're not gonna use it anymore. They're not gonna buy anything. And then he says, but also the temple of the goddess, this great goddess, Diana. Well, she was so great. What am I gonna say? If she was so great. Yeah, she was so great, can't she fight for herself? Like, if she's really God, why you gotta do that? And through this whole process here, and it says Diana may be despised and her magnificence destroyed. Now, I'm pretty sure he partook of that sexuality also, but again, it was about money, dollars and cents. Look at that verse 28, someone read. They hear this guy speaking, and notice what happens in here. Read that commentary. Go ahead and read that commentary, and I want you to feel it. Mm-hmm. money. Meets with the silversmiths, says our pocketbook is being affected, and Great Diana and her magnificence is being challenged. And all of a sudden, those silversmiths start to get religious. That's what it is. Religious is the worship of their God. They become religious and they begin to chant what? Great is that. Can you feel it? Now it's bigger. It's not just a pocketbook thing, but now it's a frenzy spirit. It's the mob spirit. And some of you have been a part of that. You were at concerts and you went in there. You're a good church girl, good church boy. You went to this concert and people started getting crazy over that favorite song. And you're like, I'm not gonna do it. But by the end of the concert, you done pulled this stuff out, you done falling all over the stage, running for the stage. You know who you are. You know who you are. You just lost yourself. Just lost yourself, woke up in a tattoo bar, you don't know what happened. Just a frenzy. They ought to be saying amen, just talking about your neighbor. But this whole frenzy overtook you. And that's how the enemy gets to you. They go from logic, it's very logical, to this spirit scream for Diana. When it was based in their pocketbook, and now this mob scene grows. Be careful who you hang around with. It's infectious. I'm telling you, young men, young women, be careful who you hang around with. Because there's spirits. I've been in some places I had to get out. I had to get away because it was bigger than just a person. I felt some strong spirits. I'm like, what is this I'm feeling? You know, like I told you that song, if loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. That's how the enemy comes and starts messing. Amen. He starts messing with our minds. And that's how you end up on News 2 and Fox 8. You do. I'm serious. That's how you end up. The enemy gets you in a frenzy and stuff. And then you up there, and they got a profile on you like that. And then people are saying, Brown was just such a good man. We saw at the service station and everything. And then you know he was getting in the car with the girl. And they were just and the big guy. You know, you're like, what happened to Brown? Spirits. Don't take that for granted. Spirits. And this is what's happening. That frenzy spirit is overtaking them. Yes, ma'am. To make you feel bad, but I just want you to think about it. Where are you spending your money to? You know, are you spending it on such and such cable company that also does pornography? And just because you don't have those channels, they're blocked on yours, it's still paying for that whole corporate thing. And we have to think about, what am I putting my money to? You know, what am I supporting that whole process? We have to think. Now, God can give you peace on it. You have to make that choice. But I remember, and I've been very open, growing up, my parents got cable, and that was when the block was squiggly. You know, when the channels that you couldn't pay for, or you couldn't afford, the only way they could block them out, they just kind of, gee, there you go again. And I was a child in the living room, and when mama was in the bed and daddy was gone, I was trying to figure out that channel. And because every now and then, if you looked at it long enough, you kind of go, I'm serious. I'm just being honest with you. That affected me. That affected me in my thought pattern and things of that sort in those whole process. And I'm pretty sure, well, I don't know, I was going to say, maybe mama, if she'd have known that, they would have took cable out of the house. I doubt it. But this whole process, I think that's very important. These people were changed so much. they did not support it anymore. So we talk real big, but what do we support? Where's our money? My family now, we just talked about that today. There's technology now, some movies that you may want to look at and have cursing in it, it'll take those scenes out. It'll clear it out. I'm like, that's great technology, but should we even be buying the film?
Amen.
Should I be support? Should I have to change it so much just so I can look at it? Or could I choose something else? And this is what we go through in this day and time because money brings quality.
Right?
Money brings the best that Hollywood has, and lack of that, you get those little cheesy movies. And, you know, we have to make those, God, what do you want for my family? This is a change of their whole mindset. So look at this whole process as we go to that next one, verse 29, their frenzy. Yes, go ahead, ma'am.
I think what you and Tabitha brought up is a good point, because it does make you question, wow. If I spend my money on this, I'm not supporting something that's going against the will of God. Because one day I was in the car listening to the radio, and I'm listening, there was a song on, and of course it was just at the end of the song. And the song said, F my school and F my teacher too. I said, what? I was too trying to this is crazy. I parked in the parking lot. I said, who is this? I need to know who that is.
You've seen a lot of Christian films that are coming out because Hollywood realized there's a group of people that put their money towards that. But guess what? When our money is pulled away from that, because we're copying them off the internet and not paying the money. Oh, y'all want to talk about that, right? Really, y'all? I know y'all saying you're holy and sanctified. But really, that's what it comes down to. So now, if the money dwindles, guess what's going to come back? That which makes money. And I'm telling you, that which we're seeing now, all kinds of sexuality in films, the cursing, some of y'all are looking at it. Yeah, we are, because the ratings on our TVs, they're looking at it, they've got all this sophisticated technology, they know what we're looking at. So the throne, the Game of Thrones, and all them sitcoms, and the girl and the president, what was that? Empire, Scandal, all that. Y'all see? Oh, y'all don't want to talk about it. Y'all are real now. I'm serious, it's affected Bible study Wednesday night, and they put it on a Wednesday night prime time. Some of y'all are like, man, that was a good Bible study, but empire on. That's where we are. Our support. Oh, somebody said DVR. You know, it's like, there was a hand. This whole process here. So notice here, this is the whole city was filled with confusion and rushed into the theater with one accord. That's the devil. The enemy. When he wants to get all his little demons together, they do. They follow in line. It's confusion that's going. And they seize guidance. They don't even understand what's going on now, but it's just this mob that's going on. They got the Erasticus and Macedonians. Paul traveled companions. So these people that were there assisting him, those that were converted in the Macedonian area, now they're true enemies. And they're really after who? They're really after Paul, but now they just want to get anybody who's against their movement. It's really Paul that's done this through the Holy Spirit, but now they're just upset. We want blood. And I'm telling you, it's coming a day and time. That's what it is. is happening in churches with our decisions against homosexuality and things of that sort. Now people are not satisfied with us saying, okay, this is what the word says, we're not homophobic, we're not saying that God can't love you or anything, but this is what we believe, this is where we stand. Now they're trying to set up Christians. They're trying to get us and come against us. They don't respect our, we try to respect their beliefs, and we just say, okay, you believe that, but the word says this, I'm just telling you what Jesus said, but now they're not satisfied. They want to change us all. This is the mob mentality. You're going to accept it no matter what. And so this is how the enemy goes. And he's doing a great job. This whole, and it's not just with homosexuality, sexuality in general. Remember, fornication was looked down on. Sleeping with someone outside of marriage was looked down on. But now it's seen as a viable lifestyle. Even in church, some of you look at programs with preachers and pastors and bishops that have a lady or a man or both on the side. But they can preach. Okay, let's move on. Let's move on. Yes.
Pastor, man, you said that I'm sitting here with that TV early on the news when Donald Trump was put to a test and he asked a certain question. He went right back at the leader and then asked him, well, if you become president, are you going to do that then? He said, yes, I'm going to do it. So, if it's in your heart to do wrong, you're going to do wrong. God is not in that. So you're not a God-fearing man if you want to go against the grain, go against God's speaking. You see? So my thing is, if you're going to do right, do right. If you're going to do wrong, don't be out there pretending. And they got that. It's in churches, too. We got people pretending to be God-fearing people.
Got to be changed from the inside out.
Yes.
Sure.
I think it was also just emphasized when you said great, but this is a Diana of the Ephesians. So now this is not just even about their religion, it's about the pride as a city. This is something that all Ephesians are supposed to do. This is the basis for their city. So now you're not patriotic anymore if you believe in this God. You're supposed to be supporting our country, and here you are worshiping this other God that we haven't even heard it before. And I think we as Americans can sometimes get into the same mentality, you know, well, our country's accepted it. And if I don't agree with my government, then doesn't that make me un-American or unpatriotic? Shouldn't I go with what the rest of my country is saying?
Everybody else is doing. You're the only one that's trying to live holy. Come on, man. I know what they say in church and everything, but they're just talking. Everybody else is really doing this. This whole process and connecting it with our culture and our background, they're more with us than against us. So many times, really. We see in the Old Testament, there are more people who really believe the same way we believe, but oftentimes we feel like everybody. No, I think there is going to come a time that it is going to be a majority. It's going to be, you meet a pastor by every now and then, that's what the scripture said. But at this point, we got a lot of people that do believe, but slowly, that change is taking place. Slowly, and then that mob mentality, and then people just start doing anything, and they don't even question why they do it.
Another one that's definitely prevalent in colleges that we often don't talk about is evolution. The way that they push it, and most of the students that I talk to, they go, you know what? I believe that God created the world. I'm like, really? I do too. And like, 85% of the class believes in creationism, and no one will say a word because everyone is terrified of all these people, of being non-scientific, of people going, oh, well, you shouldn't go into this field because you believe such and such and so and so. And that's the mob mentality, the frenzy of just a select few being able to control people.
Yeah. You know, it's even bigger than a mob mentality. It really boils down to the spirit of Antichrist, which is behind the law. You know, ultimately, his goal is to make the world worship him and his thing. And the whole system is set up to lead us into that system, which is the one he set up on earth. And if the church does not, or those who say they believe us, does not speak quickly and firmly into the generations coming up. What all are they, the only thing they know is what they're being taught in school, in the book, which is analyzed, and set up by Christ, or Spirit, or whatever Christ. Where are they going to get it? This far as it's going to be the majority, absolutely.
Got to add a word that changed. Look at verse 30, and then I'll get that next hand. Verse 30. Someone read. Wonder why. I'm going to deal with that. Go ahead, Annie.
I was just saying, when we're in the church, we oftentimes we fellowship inside the church, and we don't fellowship outside the church. And I think that causes a lot of problems in the spirit of being secluded, where you don't fellowship each week with each other outside the church. We don't invite people into our home. We don't want to let other people know what we really are like and what we really are doing. And I think, you know, we need to get out of that. We need to be more open and transparent with each other so we can strengthen each other. We can help each other. We can minister to each other's needs when we see each other outside the church and just really be real with each other and continue that fellowship, not just between these walls here. The church is not just here. It should be everywhere.
And we have that, those who are saved, understanding about Christ. A lot of times we have double standards. Just a man, if you call me pastor, if I came out of your house, it just kind of dropped out. I recognize it. And you looked out the window. You said your lazy boy. And at that moment, whatever was on your TV, whatever you were doing, would you change it? I'm just a man, but I'm just saying my mentality. And a lot of times, because you know, we've all done that. We flip the TV in. Right? Or put the news on or something else. You know, because we say, I don't want them to know I'm looking at that. So these processes here, we really have to come, have we really been changed? So now we have Paul the Apostle. He sees this mob. He's not running away. He wants to go in. Now, this, I'll be honest, all my hands are off to him, because I'd be like, okay, that's happening over there. It's time for me to go. It's just time to leave. That's just my mentality, you know. I just like, okay, I'll let the Christian in there deal with that, and I'll come back another day for another fight. But Paul says, no, let me go in, but his disciples. What does disciples mean? Very powerful word here in the Greek as we look at the base. What does disciple mean? It's disciplined followers. That's what it means. Disciplined followers of Christ. Those who were in the word, prayer, seeking him on a daily basis. It was like, we need brothers and sisters, because sometimes even in thinking are good, we can be in the wrong.
Amen.
He thought this was good, but they had discernment. If you go in there, they're going to rip you apart. I don't think God is saying, we can't let you go, Paul. We need you. We need you to do some more work for us. It'll be okay. God's going to keep them. He's gonna cover those that are in there, and we're going to see that a little later. Ms. Aiden.
You know, you talked Sunday on Take the Stand. I think that the one choosing to take a stand and you continue to live it over the years, it becomes a part of who you are. And so things on TV that you can't see. Would you sit and watch this with Jesus? You know, that's what I always used to tell Cinco. Would you watch that with Jesus? No. Well, then that you shouldn't be letting that spirit inside. I mean, it's got to the point, I can't sit in a room with anything on the television because it offends my spirit. The words, the language, the, you know, what people are wearing, whom they're kissing, you know. And as you live it for so long, it truly becomes offensive.
Sensitivity.
Yeah.
And like, we're not setting a standard up, in a sense, for just the individual, but we're looking at the word, how it touches our heart. And we're all at different points. Okay, we're all in different points. but you do, you become sensitive. And sometimes it's not Empire that you're looking at. You can't even get through the commercials anymore.
That's right.
You know, it's those other things that are going on that's affecting us from a day-to-day basis. We're becoming like Sodom and Gomorrah. And it talks about in the New Testament with Lot, he was vexed. His soul was vexed from what he was seeing on a day-to-day basis. But he still lived in the city. He still lived in the city with his family, but he became vexed. Very proud, because when you see it from the Old Testament, we don't see that same, that viewpoint of him. But he was vexed. Every day when he saw what was going on, it tore him from the inside out. And it's our concern that, are we like these people? They became vexed. They became changed so much. I cannot go to the temple of Diana anymore. I cannot buy those things anymore. And now we see this whole process going on. Look at this next verse. Someone read, please.
Then some of the officials of Asia said, who were his friends, sent him pleading that he would not venture into the field.
Go ahead and read 32, please.
Some therefore cried one thing and some another, but the assembly was confused, and most of them did not know why they had come together.
Now what we're talking about, that's how the enemy just confusing. Most people in a mob, they don't even know why they did. You know, when you see a mob of people frenzied like that, half of them don't even know why. They just kind of got caught up. It was a while back. You remember there was a scene, it was a racial issue that happened somewhere, I forgot it. But it was a young black boy. He decided he was going to go to Baltimore and go out there and do stupid stuff. And his mama found him. Right? His mama saw him on TV or something. Remember, she went out there and grabbed him and started beating him. Right? They're like, what is your problem? And he just kind of, you know, shrunk. Like, my own with me, you don't even know what's going on. You better go home. That's what happens. The enemy gets in our mind and we do crazy stuff. Don't even know why we're doing it. We don't think about our future or anything. So Paul, they talked to these officials, agents, who were his friends. God had connected him with some influential people that had been saved and come to the knowledge of Jesus. They said, Paul, don't go in there. Please don't go in there. These people, we know these people. These are our cousins. These people are crazy. They got demons in them. Don't go in there. Please don't go in there. They convinced him, pleading that he would not venture to the theater. But because these people are just crying out all kinds of stuff. The central theme is Diana. That is their idol. That's who they're lifting up, this whole process. And look at this. This confusion was so strong by this time, the mob was completely out of control. Many did not know why they were there. Conflicting voices were heard on every hand. You hear it in our society? A lot of the arguments that are being portrayed in the media and politics, they don't even make sense. That doesn't even make sense. Politicians are changing their stances. Democrats, Republicans, they believed one thing last year, and now they've evolved to something else, and they're just, it's like two-tone. Who can you trust? And it's not even on the outside of church, it's in church. People shifting on positions, and you know, well, I know the Bible says that, but, and all these words that we use. Nobody wants to take a stand. This is that mob mentality, confusion. The logic doesn't even make sense anymore. Look at that next part. Did I get all the hands? Someone read, please.
And they threw Alexander out of the multitude, the Jews putting him forward. And Alexander motioned with his hand and wanted to make his defense to the people.
All right. What's happening? What's going on? They're in the theater. What just occurred? Okay, all right. They drew Alexander out of the multitude. All right, and what does Alexander want to do? Yeah, he wants to speak up. He wants to speak up. Doubtless his purpose was to defend the Jews as being completely innocent in this matter. So in that multitude, there are people that are not caught up. They've been attacked. They're kind of around. There's some people that have rationale. They want to stop this, but usually the mob mentality doesn't want to listen to the right. It gets to a point, logic ceases. It ceases. Now, we're going to see a little later, God's grace is going to come in, but logic ceases. They don't want to listen to that anymore. Look at that next verse. Someone read, please.
No more.
No more.
I'm going to stop on this verse, and I want to give you a little homework. I want you to answer that question that's under that. Why did this happen? Alexander is getting ready to use logic. We talked about that mob mentality. But when they found out that Alexander was a Jew, right, like Paul, going to give you some hints here, they cried out, for how long? Now, I can't get y'all to shout 10 minutes for Jesus. I mean, see, I'm going to say, all right, we're going to be here for 2 hours. I just want to go, Jesus, 5 minutes. Steady here. I just want you to, how does this happen that this mob has the energy to shout for 2 hours? Great ears, Diane. Amen. All right, stay here. Come on to your feet. Let's close up.